is this line here.
Right.
This web kit background flip text. Now, unfortunately, Firefox and all the other browsers as well only support something called content box, which is if you have content in there, you use that value itself. Now, whether or not they're going to change that, we all hope they do. WebKit seems to be the only one that's going to work. As soon as I add that, you notice how all of a sudden my text has that inner shadow. And all that's being done is that's the actual background of it.
So let me just do a cutting
Everybody can see that, right? Can see the hello?
Yes.
Right? If I change the background color to red, do you see how it changes? It's not black anymore, it's just red. Right? So that inner shadow that you're seeing isn't actually a shadow, it's just back and forth. And it's like a drop shadow is in the next version. It's actually faking out the eyes. You'll notice, unfortunately, I can't zoom in here. See really close down here, like really close, how there's a bit of gray at the bottom? That's actually a bad thing to see, but your eye doesn't catch that, it only catches the dark shadow on top. Because this here is actually that drop shadow overlapping on top of the background. So, although this is not a good thing to see, we don't see this visual. So this is how you create that, unfortunately, not the web. One of the things that is used instead of this, however, is something in this, I know it looks horrible, but I'm going to give it as an example, is the letterpress effect, right? Has anybody seen those letterpress effects? Anybody?
Yes.
Yes.
If you haven't, you can say no. I'm not going to get offended. I'm not the one who designed it. Right? So, all you're doing with this one, instead of actually taking the background clip out, you're just giving it two different drop shadows. Now, you're mentioning there how the drop shadows work, right? The way this is working is you're giving it a drop shadow, but you're giving it so that, as a human being, I always perceive light coming from the top of something and coming down. So I'm doing the opposite for a drop shadow. I'm saying the dark is at the top and the light is at the bottom. And the way I'm doing this, does everybody know you can add multiple different objects or multiple different styles and designs to an object? Like, for instance, multiple text shadows, multiple backgrounds. Has anybody heard of that? In order to do those types of things, this is what this demo is actually supposed to do, and I apologize, that got off track. If I only give this one text shadow here, right? Is everybody comfortable with the text shadow function? Everybody know what it is? It's text shadow?
Quite boring.
I can't see it though.
Okay.
No, not there. No.
That good?
Oh, you took out the there it is.
I don't know if I'm. So, the way text shadow has like blue on black is not really good, is it?
It's okay.
Is there, can everybody read the blue on black?
It's fine.
Yeah. The way text shadow ends up working is you have three values and a color, right? So you were talking earlier how the drop shadow is the light that you get when you're angling it. Right? First value is your X. Positive, view would be positive, negative, right? If I said that this one it was 4 pixels, that's gonna move it over 4 to the right. If I say -4, it's gonna move it to the left, -4. If I do 0, it's basically just dead straight in the middle, right? Same thing with the second one, that's my Y, put up and down. For you, yeah, up and down. The third one is the blur. If I do 60, probably won't be able to see it, or very little. 6, you're gonna see a little bit more. Can everybody see the shadow of that? Everybody can see that, right? Looks horrible, but it's there. 6 points, 1 point, right? 10 points, 1900 points. Yay, crash! Almost left, actually. By the way, just as a heads up, don't put 1900 down. It may crash the browser. quickly see if I can recover. Does anybody have a good story?
It almost seems like that first effect. I saw somebody trying to replicate using three drop shadows this week, but yeah, I don't like the effect, so I didn't actually read it.
No worries. No, we can definitely take a look at how to do it. It's actually quite simple to write.
You stuck in a loop there?
No, it actually does a nice job to record. We're on, which one? Letterpress?
Yeah.
So this one here. And letterpress. We should know. Before I actually do this, I'm going to remove that. Because that would have been a mistake. So, as you can see, that's better. So what ends up happening is if I only do, say, 2 pixels, and I do a negative with the first couple of values, right? It tosses it to the top left. Now, it kind of looks weird, but it does give that effect that it is actually inset rather than above there. And this is just a visual key because of the way the human eye ends up being. If you wanted to add a secondary value, the only thing you needed to do is add a comma and then go into it. Now, for posterity's sake and organization's sake, I tab over and just start writing it again. And if I go 2px, 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 the same thing as before, right? And white. Now it's doing the opposite and giving me this nice little thing at the bottom. So visually, this is giving that effect of it being like a few text. Now, if you tone back those two different colors to values of gray instead of this sharp black and white, you'll have a much more subtle look, which is exactly what things like letterpress end up being, right? If you don't use black, you use, say, RGB 40-40-40 for the one, and perhaps instead of doing white, RGB maybe 180, and I'm pulling numbers out of nowhere. 180, it's a bit different, right? It's a bit more subtle. Right. So the less the values, the less contrast, the better the subtle fit of the design. But that's how you do letterpress. Has anybody ever used letterpress before in their designs? Yes? Is that how they made it?
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah? By all means, is there another way to do it?
That no, pretty much the same. I think it wasn't really
So are you doing more?
Like it was much smaller font sizes, so.
Oh yeah. Once again, this demonstration. Please never design fonts and typefaces this big. For the love of all, this holy merciful. For the love of Heidelberg, never do that. So that was that one. Next one we have, which is something that everybody is going to love. I say that because I want you to love it. Inner gloves. So, before I get and open this, I want to show you how simple the code is for this. Okay? Now, picture this as a list of something, right? Including list items. There's no div, my button, span, a link, all that stuff. It's just simple div, 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 right? Complexity in the code, which means it's very easy for people to get used to it. If I go into a preview mode, right? This is the way it ends up being. On mouse over, do you see the effect it's getting here? That's the mouse position to use hands. My bad. See the effect and how it actually looks like it's being inset into the page further and the other items are around it? Has anybody seen this type of design on websites? Right. Have you ever been curious in how it's done? Without images. So, this is where we can use different things like these pseudo selectors and CSS gradients combined together. So this is exactly your question, how we are actually going to be using the content, but not actually adding any content into that. So I'm going to go through just quickly here on a couple little elements. First of all, I'm going to remove the after, which is the pseudo element.
I want to make that edit window just slightly bigger.
Oh, my apologies. So right now, this is what would end up being happening, right? You're going to have this hover effect when you have two different gradients on that, right? Which we just went through gradients. Or do we go through gradients? We only briefly talked on gradients about we have different gradients. To get the effect that we're looking for, we also want to have different gradients on the left and right, more on the other. To do that, we're using the afterburner. So let's take a look. Am I going too fast? This is very awkward for me. I only had like 3 hours of action practice in this part of the session. So if I sound awkward, I do apologize. Div on hover. Everybody knows the hover command, right? Everybody's used it on an A-link.
Yes.
Good. So either hiding the underline or not. On most modern browsers, you can use hover on things aside from A-links, EID. Now, if you add, remember that content, the dash space before, right? You notice there's nothing in here. It's just basically colon marks. What this does is this is the requirement to create that object. Right? If you don't have content, this is the only key you really need to have to understand the after and before. So this is what you have to keep in mind. It doesn't have to be anything in there, but as soon as you start creating something, you can now design it. So what I'm doing with this one is I'm saying take that secondary object, that object that I'm creating, make it 100% of the parent's height, because I'm using 100% height and width, 100%, 100%. Position absolute at 0, 0, which means it should overlay exactly over top of the parent item, because the parent item has the position relative, right? Position relative that contains a position absolute makes it so that it goes by that to the page. Sorry, that's a bit of a high level. That's moving over it, but does everybody understand position, right? Everybody use positioning, relative, absolute, something like that?
Yeah,
we go into position. So. But to get an absolute, 0, 0, left should be top right. Now it's top right. Top right, 0, 0. And now we simply add the background. So I'm using the RGBA here at 30, 30, 30, 30, which gives me a nice dark gray. But what I'm also doing is I'm saying there's a 0% opacity in the middle. Right? So from the left, I'm going from 80% opacity of the black, right, over to 5%, which is 0% opacity, over to 95%, that still has 0, and then over to 0%, 100%, that's got back up to 80%. So does that make sense? All I'm doing is I'm saying in my after, create a brand new object on top of it, and color it with semi-transparency. Yes?
So when you define content, the style below content applied to the created object?
Yes. Sorry. The before, you can use before or after on this one. The difference is that where it puts that object relation to the content that is in that object. So if you have, for instance, the text, my button, in that, I'm creating an object after that content there. So if I wanted to add text to it, for instance, if I said hello, right, and refresh this, right, the text hello is going to be in that hover. You see the hello there kind of overlapping, right, because it's taking the same attributes as its parent. But if I didn't have the positioning absolute, the height and width, right, if I did this, right, see how it puts it after the content?
Can you uncomment that and then comment out the content? I just want to see what that's going to do.
If I do this, what ends up happening is nothing gets occurred. Nothing occurs because the content hello, the content area, is the only thing required or is the thing you need to have on there.
If you ever can you hover over it, right?
Sure. I've uncommented it.
No. Yeah, like that. That's cool.
Yeah.
Okay, so what's the difference between that with content and that without content?
If I don't put content here?
Yeah.
You don't get the picture.
There's no sides. Nothing on the sides. Because the object is being created.
From the hover.
Right.
But not the hover after.
Exactly. So the idea of a span or a div or any of those different tags, that's essentially an object. What I'm creating is I'm creating an object that doesn't have tags on it. Right? So this is essentially just an object, or in JavaScript terms, any of the objects you see on like a web object in JavaScript, how it contains, what its tag is, all these things. All I'm doing is I'm creating a web object or a rendering element on the page that doesn't have tags. Because the only thing a tag is to HTML is to say, what's my base style, right? Lists have bullets and padding and margin. Divs are display block, right? All the div is an object that's being defined in the browser and in the markup language.
Maybe I'm misunderstanding the concept of the div hover after, so.
Sure.
Could you explain that to me?
Absolutely. What the div hover, the div before and after, or any object before and after, what you're doing is by adding content, right? And this is the key. You need content to do anything. It's just a requirement across the board. And if that content is blank, that has no characters, that has no spaces, that has nothing, that's fine, this is the storage. But that creates an object on the page that doesn't have any tags associated to it, right? Now what you can do is you can style that any way you want, right? So if you create an empty object on a page that has no style or no default styling to it, right? It's just empty. There's the equivalent of null. And you start saying, no, it has a width of 100%. It has a height of 100%. Its position is this to its parent object or to anything on the page. And its background color is this, right? You're now giving attributes to a thing that doesn't have attributes, and therefore you can design it.
Matthew, are you able to do the hover after without the hover?
Yes. Sorry.
Maybe it'll be more obvious if you just kind of show just absolutely. The.
If I only do hover after?
No, I'm saying comment out just the hover part above. The part that just does the hover.
I just give it this. Okay.
And just show the effect of the hover after on its own, maybe. I think maybe that was the confusing part.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, right?
So think of how hover adds the gradient going down, and the hover after adds the gradient going up. That's right. Right. So that way it creates like a little echo.
If I don't have hover, and this is, sorry, this is my mistake. If I don't have hover, if I only do div after, this means by default, right? By default, they're going to be there.
Okay, so I get it. So the reason you did the limitation of defining those gradients within one style,
yes.
You have to have two instances of a background image in order to do that style.
You can do two instances of a background image, which is a complete possibility, like if you do a text style. However, the problem is that A, the support is far less than what it is for this after, and what this also allows you to do is create a background image in one that's a URL, for instance, a texture. Right? If you wanted to have the object have a texture to it, and have a gradient, and have a hover different gradient, right? You could do that using the before and after. And the key with this, many of the browsers, and this is something that they don't show in the documents either, many of the browsers actually have a problem with having multiple backgrounds where one is a gradient and one is a URL. Right? It's been brought up, but unfortunately it has not been raised yet because it's such a new technology that nobody's releasing. So this is where the content before and content after really comes in handy. Yes.
So the content, can you put that anywhere else than within a pseudo class of after or before?
If I added it to something like div,
absolutely.
So if I change content here to this, that used to work. May I take that out? That had to work because this is one of the first questions that I had asked as well, because I wanted to say, well, can I create a security thing that says CSS and takes it from the web? That's been taken out of at least the support in the browser that I've been working with. But that used to be the case.
Uh-huh.
Where you could actually replace, you know, I could put whatever I wanted to in HTML and it would be replaced by a CSS.
So at this point, we only can use content
in the pseudo selector for the support asset.
Right. Cool.
Now, that being said, I haven't checked a lot of the other pseudo selectors, and there are a few. But this one is specifically designed towards adding content before that. And this is why this is where I come across.
Good. Thank you.
Yes.
How do we select all these new creative objects?
I'm Sorry.
How do we select those new creative objects in JavaScript?
How do you select
those newly created objects in JavaScript?
My apologies. To be quite honest, I haven't done it. The thing that I would only think that you'd be able to do, and I don't know if any of the frameworks allow this, but you'd be able to select a child element, perhaps. The only thing is that it wouldn't have a tag associated. Do you have
that? No, then you have a love to draw a they're kind of invisible to the JavaScript dom, but it adds some elements to make it.
Yeah, that's a difficult one because it's such a new thing. The only thing I can think of is if it's a child selector and you're doing it through raw JavaScript. But even that, I haven't had any tests to it. I think that would be something to definitely explore. And it's a great, great thing to explore and see if there is an answer to it. I don't have an answer that I can give you. Sorry. Did anybody hear his question? Yeah? Okay. So, yes. I'm blind as well. So, taking a look back at the hover, going back now with the knowledge that we had done, do you see where this is coming from now? If I refresh this, one. Crashed it. Awesome. So, did that answer your question in regards to selectors and pseudo selectors? How? Did that describe? Are you clear?